My guest today is the Ambassador of Norway to India, Hans Jakob Frydenlund. Welcome, Ambassador.
Thank you, Mr. Ball.
You've been talking about green, clean and oceans. And one of the instruments that Norway uses to build economic relations overseas is the investment fund, the sovereign investment fund, where you actually put your surplus oil money into the fund and then invest this overseas. How is this working out with India? Because I believe that this is one of the major instruments. And we will, of course, talk about business development and jobs and perhaps even opportunities for students. But let's start with the fund.
The Sovereign Wealth Fund is a central instrument to our economic policy. It's a way to securing that the wealth we have been building through our production of oil and gas lasts for a long time coming. And as the Norwegian population is aging, so we'll foresee that we'll be more and more retirees. This is literally my pension fund. It's invested in a way where it's invested in solid capital markets like the Indians. So the effect of being there shows that the Sovereign Wealth Fund has trust in that market. And currently the investments is $14 billion and we're still counting. This is an increase. But these are investments in a number of companies on the Indian Stock Exchange with minor positions in each company.
But your total investment in India goes to approximately how many companies and what is the investment?
We are 120 Norwegian companies have invested or are present in India. That covers a vast area of activities. This is related to engineering, this is related to IT, this is related to the maritime sector, this is related to fertilizers, this is related to food and paint, to put some of the areas in which we do have economic activities. And as with the pension fund, what is important here is that the economic relations between Norway and India is not what we thought about earlier when it comes to, it was about export-import. This is about economic integration. As India is such a huge country, so if you export to India, you invest in India, but you bring with you the technology. At the same time, India is producing engineers and graduates at a huge pace. So we're also having quite a substantial number of Indians coming to Norway to work. And those are skilled laborers and professionals. It's the biggest immigrant group in Norway outside the EU for the time being. And we also see that Norwegian companies are outsourcing to India. For instance, a Norwegian engineering company, Aker Engineering, has 1,400 engineers in Mumbai and Pune. So the activity is just a contact between the two companies. It doesn't relate to necessary trade figures, but the integration is stronger and stronger.
But the new areas of hydrogen and electric vehicles, that's something that Norway is now looking to do more with many countries around the world, and India is one of them. In fact, I believe in Norway, you probably have the most per capita income sales of electric cars currently in Europe, or perhaps even in the world, one of the top in the world. So you are going into electric, especially for mobility in a big way. What is it that you're looking at in India? Are you seeking partners in India, and are you planning to make a base here?
Well, here you haven't had two level. First, what you're now pointing at is the commercial part of it, which also is on the larger part of obtaining our goals when it comes to climate and environment. And we're not able to actually achieve the SDGs or to be able to combat climate change without actually India succeeding. So we need to see India succeed. So that's part of our India strategy, which focuses on the work on oceans, environment, climate and renewable energy. So, and in this context, what is we're focusing the most on just now is hydrogen, because that's coming up. with the Prime Minister's National Hydrogen Mission, which was announced on the day of independence, which is a very important step to find new ways of producing renewable energy. And when it comes to hydrogen, Norway has over a 100-year-long history in producing hydrogen, which emerged as a byproduct of something else Norway is known for, fertilizers. So we have a long history of knowing how to deal with hydrogen when it comes to production and when it comes to regulation and when it comes to safety, which is important in this aspect. So we are now looking into how can we make how can we connect Indian businesses and Norwegian business in this, and we haven't just had a major Norwegian business delegation coming to India to look into the opportunities.
So that, in fact, is one of the major obstacles for small and medium business people, how to connect, and they need to learn a lot about Norway and when these delegations are coming, how to make contacts there. What is your suggestion? How should they go about it?
Well, we are cooperating with the big Indian business associations like CII, like FICCI, and in this case, PhD CCI. So it's working. I think we're working through the business association, but also taking direct contact with us here at the embassy and at the our commercial section.
And where are the opportunities now? If you look at it in a broad sense, where do you see the opportunities? Which sectors?
Well, we see the opportunities when it comes to everything that has to do with renewable energies, because we have long history when it comes to, when you start with it, hydroelectrical power. It was hydroelectrical power that built our wealth, not oil and energy, not oil and gas. That came afterwards. We have a tradition when it comes also to harness the wind, which is also one of the major sector now. We have an industry which is very much based on high tech, and where we very often cooperate with Indian engineers to actually get the scope that's necessary, because Norway is a small country, so we need to cooperate with a vast pool of professionals to be able to succeed. So these are some of the areas. Then you have everything which is related to ocean, because our wealth has almost come from ocean, except from the hydroelectrical power, fish, and then after oil and gas, and the maritime sector. When I grew up, you went to sea to earn money, and we're still strong on that. So the whole spectrum of ocean industries, fisheries, fish farming, and so on, is another major pillar of our cooperation and the potential for cooperation.
Let's look at the reverse now. Opportunities for Indians in Norway. Where do you see those? Because I believe education is still free, even for foreigners in certain institutions in Norway. But there are certain riders. Do you see that as being one of the steps to build future relations? Because they say if you have a student from a foreign country in one of your universities, you have a friend overseas for life.
Absolutely. And as I said, education in Norway is free. We have a small number of private universities, but they're also relatively cheap, as several of the major costs are taken care of. This is world-class education, and we see a growing interest from Indian students going to Norway. Last year, I remember I met a PhD student at the Norwegian School of Business Administration, extremely happy, and it was, you had to admit, this was recent winter Norway. But you also see the go for the high-tech element. It's one of 10 students in a PhD program for data security in Norway is an Indian. We see that there is a growing interest, but also we have the traditional interest. When if you look into the fields like hydroelectrical power, ocean sciences, and polar sciences, you will find a substantial number of Indians who have been studying in Norway and getting their education in Norway. In this field, we have very close connections. I suppose you know there is a India has a research station in Spitsbergen, which is our Arctic archipelago. And why in Spitsbergen? Is that just because you're going to that some kids who are extremely interested in cold areas go there having fun? No, because the globe is so small that observations from that station helps India predict the movements of the monsoon. This is very close to India's core interest, having a number of scientists up there. And they've all been to Norwegian universities.
How important is it for potential students to learn Norwegian? Because the language of instruction in Norway may be a mixed Norwegian and English system.
Well, that depends on the level. So, but on graduate and postgraduate level, English is sufficient. If you want to do undergraduate, you will have to learn Norwegian first. So that is maybe a challenge. So we don't expect to receive that many undergraduate students. But on the other levels, there is no problem when it comes to language.
What about job opportunities in Norway? Because there are some, but then there is also a bit of a problem when it comes to immigration and work visas. So do you think that there is potential for Indians to look for jobs there?
Well, it's many way the other way around. Norwegian employers will come to India to look for employees. Indians is the biggest work immigrant group in Norway outside the EU. 25,000 Indians has gone to Norway in the last years. And I don't know the figure every year because it fluctuates and people are going back and forth all the time. But I very often come across Indians who has been working in Norway for periods of time.
Well, Ambassador, thank you so much for sharing your views with us, and we wish you luck.
Thank you, and thank you for having me.